Hello and welcome to episode 54 of the fantastic True Achievements podcast. I've given it an adjective to describe it, which is unusual, but it is fantastic, isn't it? Got to agree with that. I'm joined today by Jack and Dave. How are you, Jack?
I'm very well, thank you.
Excellent. Dave, you cool?
Lively buzzing. On a Friday. Yes, buzzing. How are you?
Buzzing, excellent. Yeah, not too bad, thank you. Excited, actually, because I have been playing something that we didn't even know existed until about 20 hours ago, which was new Codemasters rally game, DiRT 4, the actual successor to DiRT 3, which I think came out in 2011, so it's been a long time coming. Obviously, DiRT Rally came out very, very recently. What was that? Beginning of last year?
Yeah, it was last year. It came out the year before on the PC, I think.
Okay. Well, yeah, so it has been a while. Because I was thinking when I was there yesterday that at the event that it hadn't been that long. But talking to the guys there, they've been working on it for a reasonable amount of time. And it brings some new things to the franchise, which they haven't had before. I guess key things are the new normal mode. So there's like a normal and a simulator mode. Because one of the big criticisms of the DiRT games previously, especially DiRT Rally, was that its difficulty is pretty stiff for those that aren't very, very natural racers or very experienced in the racing genre. So they have made what they just called normal mode, which is the default, and that has a load of assists turned on. So it should make the driving experience a little bit easier for those that are coming to the game for the first time. I was using that mode yesterday, and I found myself coming off the track or the stage very rarely, which is unusual because I remember the first time I played DiRT Rally, I was off the side of a mountain more than I was actually on the road. It was proper off-roading. Whereas yesterday, there were a few times when I came off, but that was me not listening properly to the co-pilot. That seems to be the key to this game. I was trying to play it while talking to someone, and as soon as you stop listening to the co-pilot, you're doomed. Right. So I played it on both controller and on the wheel and pedal set. Both were excellent. The wheel does seem a bit harder because flicking the direction to correct any steering issues or the back end going out obviously takes longer when you're turning a wheel than just flicking a controller over. Plus, braking with your feet for some reason is harder than using just your fingers. I don't know whether it's because it's a natural thing. I expect if you were to play the game in the wheel all the time, you wouldn't have those problems. But for me, I found it easier on the pad. The other key innovation for this game is that there is a brand new track design mode called My Stage, and it's amazing. It's you choose a country. So all the countries have their own sort of style. So obviously you've got the Scandinavian tracks where it's snowy, and you've got the like outback Australia stuff where it's really dusty. All the countries have their own sort of grip and different characteristics. But on My Stage, you can choose a country, and then you have two sliders. Nice and simple. You have length of stage, and you have complexity of stage. And you can move them up and down, and then you just click generate stage, and it builds a perfect stage for you just based on your settings. And you can view it from above like a map, but it's like a 3D map, so you can see the height changes and whether it's like an uphill or a downhill stage or whether it's generally flat. And if you don't like the look of it, you can just click generate another one, and it's basically an infinite amount of stages for you. And obviously I'm not a massive rally aficionado, so I don't know every stage off the top of my head that are in the real rally games.
Right, yeah.
So while it has all of that as well, I could literally tell no difference at all between a real rally stage that they've mapped out, to within meters of reality, to the generated ones. They both felt exactly the same to play, which is pretty incredible. And they were really, really excited about that facet of the game. I think it's out in June, so we were playing a pretty early build. It said pre-alpha on the build, but I didn't see any crashes. Computer crashes. I crashed constantly. but no technical issues at all, which is amazing. I also had a go at a mode called Land. I think it's called Land Rush, and that's in like caged buggies. you know, those sort of buggies with massive wheels and very little car, but just a, like, this is effectively a cage that you sit in on wheels. And that was laps. And that was awesome. They also emphasized that they've added a lot more rallycross stuff. I know one of the major criticisms of rally games is that you're not racing against anyone, you're just against the clock, and that can be a bit boring. So rallycross is like where multiple drivers race on the same track at the same time against each other, and it's generally laps. And they've beefed up that mode. That was certainly my favourite mode in Dirt Rally. So that's cool. That wasn't playable, but the other two modes were, and they were both really, really good. So I'm very excited about that game. I think it's out in June.
Yes.
Thanks to Codemasters for inviting us on, and hopefully we'll get a bit more... we hope to speak to one of the developers of the game in the coming weeks and get some more info on that.
One question about that mouse stage. Is it every time you create one, is it a totally new stage that it builds, or is it like a section from...
It's totally new. It's like generated from nothing. But all you've set is basically the environment and the length and difficulty.
And are you limited?
I mean, it says complexity, which I guess is the same as difficulty.
Are you limited to a single environment, or could you pick a couple to so you could go from like snow to kind of forest?
Not in the same stage, as far as I could tell. I mean, yesterday the only thing you could build was the Australia stuff, so it was all dusty. You could specify the weather as well, so you could race in like rain and stuff like that. The other cool thing is that you can set challenges. So once you've built your stage and you've raced it and you think that was actually brilliant, you can then share that stage with other people, upload it, and race it with your friends, which is pretty sweet. Cool. I mean, it's a massive innovation. They were a little bit nervous about, you know, how much of a game changer it was. So if you like your driving games, I think it will really appeal.
It sounds like a bit like the Blueprint system, do you know, in Horizon, but like one step further on.
yeah because you're setting, well, Blueprint's completely open, isn't it? You can set the route and the time and the and all sorts of other factors. This is a bit, I would say it's narrower, but it's doing what much more.
Yeah, totally.
Because you've not got the open world there to start with. It was really impressive. So we hope to find more about that. There's a story gone up, and there's a video trailer in the story as well. So if you're interested in that, check it out. We have continued our ID streaming this week. We have moved platform. I'll skip over to the site news just for this. So we've moved our streams from Twitch to Beam for the first week. For the first time, and it's gone pretty well. We've had a week of it now. The streaming is much snappier. There's much less lag, which is pretty cool. There's been a couple of people saying that they've had lag issues while watching it on their phone, but only a couple. And I think the same issues existed on Twitch as well.
Yeah.
I've got to say, I love the Beam interface. Like, having
really
spent some time with
really
it.
Really smooth,
so,
isn't it?
So slick.
It's just for clicking in all the animations. It's really subtle. But
it doesn't feel like you're in a... I mean, go to it in your browser, like on your desktop and something. It feels like you're in an app. It doesn't feel like you're just in a browser. It's very, very slick. I've been really impressed with that. And we've had no problem. Well, the first day we had a couple of problems with the contest.
Us not knowing the command.
But there's a lot of bots and stuff you can do. It's been pretty cool. And we're gathering a nice following. We're getting a regular group of people in there watching us every day, which is pretty cool. And as usual, we have streamed a vast array of different game types this week. So, Jack, let's start with what you played yesterday, because it's freshest in the mind.
Yep.
So, Toby and the Secret Mine.
Yeah, Toby and the Secret Mine. So it's a little platformer, and the premise of the game is that there's a big person capturing your friends and putting them in cages, and you've got to traverse through the environments and find your friends and just get to the end of a level. A couple of little puzzle elements in there. Overall, it seemed like quite an easy and quite a quick game. So I think in the hour I played it for, I got through all but one of the levels.
Wow.
Mm.
So it's not a very long game.
Well, that was looking at the level select, but I'm not too sure if it just tacked more levels onto the end as I progressed through.
There's 21 in total.
So 21 in total. So I think I got through the majority of them then, and I collected over half of the friends while I was going through. But it was good, though. Really good fun. Really solid gameplay. And really simple as well. It was literally left and right, A to jump and B to interact with things. And that was it.
Yeah, and it looked visually, it was very Limbo-esque, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, I'd say more like similar. Feast, which was another ID title we played a couple of months ago. But it seems to be a style a lot of games are going for, the kind of silhouette in the foreground and the ambient colours in the background.
I think a lot of games have kind of come out, and it's like Limbo's kind of spawned its own little genre.
Yeah.
And you can imagine that they've all seen Limbo and thought, do you know what, I made this better if there was colour in the background, and then they've all kind of different development times and they're all kind of dripping out now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Inside did a similar thing, didn't it? Obviously the same developer as Limbo.
But, yeah, but there was Badland as well. That was very similar, like silhouettes on a coloured background. But I played this last night and I finished it. I got the 1,000. There's a really good guide on... There's two guides on TA. There's one that's like a full game walkthrough. Mm-hmm. I didn't use that one. There's one that's just like list the levels and where the friends are in that map. So I did that.
Okay.
I thought it was really good, but there's some really cheap deaths in it. Do you know, like a good platformer to me is like, you know, it'll kind of show you what you need to do and then it's difficult and you have to try and work your way through. This, though, you'd be walking along and all of a sudden some spikes would just pop out the ground and kill you. Well, and it's like, there's no
that
warning.
That is like Limbo. Limbo did that the first time round.
There's just no warning to it or anything. It's like so... And some of them is just like total... It doesn't give you... I don't know. They just... You've got to... You die and then you've got to try to keep... It's just replaying it over and over again, try to get past certain little bits. It seems a bit cheap in points, but...
The bit I found difficult, there are sections in it where there are kind of two wooden posts coming out of a floor, and as you're walking along, you'll hear some creaking. And if you jump on that section, you can drop down to another like subsection of the map, and in the first kind of half of the levels that's all fine, you can just jump on any of those. Second half introduces spikes to those, so you've got a 50% chance of just dying or 50% chance of falling down and finding something cool. But
so it's a lot of trial and error
going on. There is an achievement for 100 deaths.
That's one I
got that about halfway through the game.
Yeah, I got 69 playing yesterday. So
how long were you playing it, Dave, to get the full 1K?
Xbox said 2 hours, 10 minutes.
Okay.
But I bet that was me pausing. I'm not totally sure.
Okay, we'll look that up. Let's move on to the assembly.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember this
one. So this was it's made by a company that make VR games or specialise in VR games.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
obviously, the Xbox doesn't have a VR, so it had some quirky functionality in the controls, but the game overall, it was a bit of a, I'd almost say a walking simulator with kind of puzzle aspects to it.
Was this the one that was like inside like some kind of facility?
Yeah, it was in a facility. Yeah. So you were kind of walking around laboratories and you start off in an office. You go through to a lab and you have to find a sample. And there's kind of an overarching story where there's some conspiracy going on. And you eventually get to trials, which are just kind of big puzzles that you've got to finish. Yeah. So it's either moving some cubes around a map or turning all the lights off on pillars. So it's just I'd almost say puzzles interspersed with walking and environment searching.
This was the one with the
huge there was a lot of interaction.
The huge sandwiches. Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of huge sandwiches. But a lot of interaction with the environment. It's more like a
it was almost like the non-action sections of Quantum Break. Because you had so much to interact with. You had computers and you could read through various emails on each.
A lot of drawers.
Yeah, a lot of drawers to open.
So how many achievements did we pop? About six, wasn't it? Something like that.
A reasonable amount.
We had someone in the chat helping us, guiding us. Mark, who wrote the review, was helping us out with a few of the missables. If you do play the game and you want to get the full achievement list on the way through, you will need to use the guides on TA because there are quite a few missables.
Missables, but I think there's a level select as well.
Okay, so at the end.
So in that sense, you can just go back and tidy them up.
Okay. So, reasonably enjoyable. I wouldn't say it was amazing.
Yeah, I thought it was good. The one mechanic I loved about it, to save yourself walking, you could hold the left trigger and it projected a character model forward and you could just hit A to teleport to that place.
Yeah, I think that was from the VR functionality, I'm guessing. Okay, the next one was a really interesting one for me, Metrico Plus, which was almost like, it felt like a video game based on a GCSE maths lesson or something. It was very, there was like X's and Y's and numbers and stuff all floating around. It was a sort of left to right scrolling game with a very sort of simple aesthetic, but it worked really nicely, didn't it? Really clean, very simple colours, lots of angular objects, like just simple spheres and simple cones and stuff like that to traverse. But a puzzle platformer where you just had to get from one side of the map to the other, but there was lots of interesting puzzles on the way. And they introduced it, I don't know how many levels there were in total, maybe 6, 8, but they introduced a new mechanic on each one, which is quite cool. I like it when games do that. But yeah, this was really enjoyable, quite challenging at times. There's a whole load of, as well as achievements for beating each level, there's a whole load of, like, what would you call them, speedrun challenges where you have to complete the level in a short time, and some of those times looked really tricky.
Yeah.
But I thought this was really good, really different. I've never played a game like it. I don't know if it's a port from a phone game, possibly.
I think there was a Metrico, because this is the Plus version, so...
souped up.
I think it was.
There's definitely one on the Vita, I think, as well, weren't there? I remember seeing that on TV.
Yeah, well as a little handheld game, I think. But you'd need the controls, because... Yeah, I don't think it would work with just touchscreen, because you need fairly precise controlling of your character and jumping and shooting and all sorts of other things. But no, I thought it was cool. We got quite a few of these ones as well.
You got 4 out of 17
of these ones. Well, felt like a lot at the time.
It was a lot of effort, some of those puzzles.
I know, they really were. And we went back and tried to redo
I've seen so many in Street. Was that the one where like you jump and that'd move one part of the map and then walking one way? Right. Yeah.
Like if you were touching the floor and moving right, it might move something upward. But if you weren't touching the floor and you were moving right, it wouldn't move it upward.
Sort of braid mechanics in places. But without the time element. It was cool. Let's talk about Iron Bread, which has been a game that we first saw at Rezzed probably 2 years ago. There was a big... It was quite weird, because Rezzed is quite... felt like quite a serious event. And then in the middle of one of the rooms, there was just people dressed as bread and just big like pieces of bread stuck on walls. And it was a bit bizarre. It just really stuck out. But that had the biggest queue out of all of... There was like a pretend kitchen... that they'd made, and just loads of people were queuing up to play it. So it piqued our interest then. We didn't actually play it, but we watched a few people playing it. And it's finally come out on Xbox this week, and our review's just gone up. But Jack, why don't you tell us what you thought of it?
It was very tricky. It took me maybe about 40 minutes to get the hang of the controls, to be honest.
So now a live stream.
Yeah, you have the shoulder buttons and the triggers, and they independently, if you hold one of them, it will lock that corner of the bread to a surface if it's touching it. So in order to move, you've got to figure out what triggers you need to push or what shoulder buttons, and then use the stick to orientate the bread around those points. So they act as pivot points. So the technique I worked out eventually was to always have 2 points of contact and then roll it about those 2 points to stop you kind of skewing or rotating in the other axes as you were moving.
Sounds complicated. And what's the point?
So you play a piece of bread as you roll across the map. If you touch things, you become inedible, and you've got to try and toast yourself before you become inedible.
So it's a standard plot.
Standard plot. There are various ways to toast yourself. So the first level was a kitchen, and there was a toaster, which for some reason I couldn't get into. It just wouldn't. I've seen people online do it, so it is possible. I ended up going to the hob and turning that on, and then you've got to toast both sides as well, which becomes trickier. There was one level where I was toasting myself on an iron and tried to flip over to the other side and fell off the ironing board.
Oh,
so it was a disaster. But...
Bizarre. Okay, so our review has, spoilers, given it 1.5 out of 5.
It seemed okay, though, but the achievement list is ridiculous if you're not good at it. You've got to get an A++ on every level.
Oh, okay. Okay, so it might be one to steer clear of if you are a completionist. Yeah, it is weird. I like watching you play it. I was like, what on earth? What? Yeah. Just bizarre. Okay. Towerfall Ascension. This was something we played on Wednesday, I think. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember it now.
It was the co-op game with Yarrows.
Oh, of course it was. Yes. So this reminded us of one we played a couple of weeks ago, which was a single screen co-op stroke versus game.
Wonder Wars,
that's it, yeah. So this one, you had very limited set of arrows. You had various worlds that you had to complete, and each world you had maybe 6, 7, or 8 different parts, levels to that world, all of which had to be completed consecutively with your set amount of lives. So we had 5 lives each, and you're on, it's a single page map, single screen map.
It's almost like an arena, isn't it? A little.
Yeah, it is an arena. And it's almost like there's like Pac-Man sort of walls around the level.
Yeah,
and you have to
drop out of
around
one side and in the
yeah,
other.
Exactly. Very similar to Pac-Man. So you can come off one side and come in the opposite side. Lots of not randomly spawning enemies, lots of spawning enemies, but their spawn points were pretty consistent. So you could hang around, you could see when they're about to spawn. And the idea was to clear all of those spawned enemies, and then you get onto the next level. But some of the enemies were really tough,
Yeah, it was okay. There were kind of flying enemies and standard enemies just moving across the floor. They couldn't shoot anything back at you. So the technique for those was just to jump on them.
Yeah, it's like a Mario style. Yeah. You can kill enemies by jumping on them. Because actually shooting them was reasonably tricky, even though it had a bit of a homing missile on the arrows. Because you only had 4, I think, in fact, you only start with 3. If you fire those 3 arrows, and I'm one of the type of people that just hammers the shoot button, so I would try and hit something and fire all 3 of my arrows. And if I missed, I would be unarmed until I could go and collect those arrows. So actually, it was a lot easier to spend most of the time just jumping around and trying to land on the enemies.
Yeah.
You could also shoot each other, which was a bit of a pain. So that also made it less likely for us to use the arrows.
Yeah, that was frustrating because I'd see an enemy across the map, shoot an arrow and accidentally kill you.
Yeah, and when you've only got 5 lives to last the entire sort of six to eight levels, that made it pretty tricky. The good thing was if one of us got through a level and the other didn't, you would both respawn at the start of the next. So it gave you an extra life, basically. Mm-hmm.
Was one of the enemies like a replica of one of the characters? So you didn't know which.
Oh yeah, that was the worst bit. So yeah, they'd like make ghosts of you that looked identical to you, and obviously your opponent or your co-op partner is trying to shoot that person. But also, because there's so many enemies kicking about, you find yourself very focused on your side of the screen. We came up with a tactic that one of us would stick because of the issues with shooting each other. You'd have to split the screen in 2, effectively. One of you deal with one side and one of you deal with the other. So you weren't really focused on what the other guy was doing because as soon as you took your eye off your guy, you'd die. So when it came round to having these ghost enemies that looked identical to your opposition, you'd have to say, right, which one's you? And it was really difficult. Really difficult. So I think we finished 8 of the 9 levels or something.
But yeah, we got to the last one. We got to really annoying boss, didn't we?
Yeah, it had like a skull, big bad enemy thing, floating skull that fired bullets and lasers.
But
and all
that proved to be too tricky.
Yeah, we couldn't beat that one. But I think given another 10 minutes, we'd have got through that.
But it's worth noting that was only the normal mode. There is hardcore and a legendary.
Legendary above that, yeah. And it was pretty tough. Well, the early levels were relatively straightforward, but it did get harder. We certainly had to redo quite a few of them. Quite enjoyable. Not amazing. Certainly, I wouldn't think it was a solo game. You'd need someone to play with or against.
I think it was couch co-op only as well, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, there's no online.
Yeah,
no.
And some of the achievements are a bit mental. Like, there's play 5,000 versus matches. I don't think it has that replayability factor.
No, I think you'd struggle to do 50, let alone 5,000. That's a crazy achievement. I imagine they'll adjust the...
I don't know if you could just... well, they've got one for 1,000 as well.
So yeah.
If they adjust them to like 100 and 250, I think that'd be reasonable.
Yeah, reasonable. We'll have words. But yeah, I think you can adjust the number of deaths required to finish a round, so you could just stick it to one. I mean,
stick
you could
to
boost
one and
that,
just keep hammering the button. Yeah.
How long would it take
to boost? You don't want to boost something like that, though. You want to just get it naturally while you're playing, don't you?
I don't think the game's got enough replayability for 5,000 games.
No. Well, the thing we found confusing as well, there's only versus and co-op on the menu.
Yeah, there was no single player.
The single player, you just pick co-op and put it on one person.
Yeah. Yeah, that was weird.
Interesting.
Yeah, strange. Okay, so that's it for new games that we've been playing, but it is GTASC continues, and we're still in. So we have been playing games for some score, as well as fun, I'm sure. Dave, you've been silent throughout the last 20 minutes of talking. What have you been playing apart from Toby and the Secret Mine?
Well, on Saturday, is it Sunday it finishes the period, doesn't it? Yeah. So Saturday night we were dangling around the elimination point.
What you normally do on a Saturday night.
Me and Jack ended up pretty much pulling an all-nighter.
I played until 5.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. I played Madden NFL 06, which is if you can play, you have to play one real game, and you can adjust the sliders to pretty much cheat everything in.
Yeah.
And then there's just one, so annoying, there's one last achievement you need, which is for playing 30 years of franchise modes, which is like 30 seasons. So I sat here doing that, and for some reason my 360 in this room has issues where it randomly drops offline. So the big one at the end, the 400 game score on it, had actually gone offline as it popped. So I was a bit gutted. Yeah, you can get the rest of the 600 in probably 20 minutes or something. It's one game, really easy. But then that big one, epic fail.
You don't have to be good at American football games to.
No, you don't even have to understand. You're just the slider, so you cheat all the rules and just like stand wherever you want and do whatever you need to do, really.
So after that, you've played the 10-year more recent version of Madden NFL.
Yeah, so I looked at the Madden series is that I've been it's on Sky TV here on a Sunday night, like the proper NFL, and I've been watching some of the matches on that, just sat on the set. The football finishes like the soccer, and then after I've had a few beers and I can't be bothered moving, and then that's like on next. So I've been kind of watching it. So I've got quite into American football at the minute. So that's why I looked at the Madden series. That's why I saw there was an easy game. And then, on EA Access, I'm not paying full price for one. So on EA Access, it's free, Madden NFL 16. So thought I'd give that a go last night. There's the first achievement I popped was like 100 gamer score. I don't know why. And it was rare, I think, but it was just for doing the tutorial. It was a bit weird.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, from what I've seen, it looks... There's some that are kind of... What is their version of, like, FIFA's Ultimate Team, which I'm never going to get, because I understand the basic... I understand the basic rules of American football, but as soon as you start getting into, like, the actual play of the game and where to stand and which play to call and stuff, I've got no idea. I just throw the ball and see what happens type thing. So I'm not going to get them, but yeah, it was enjoyable enough. Looks quite good, but they do need. I noticed like FIFA got the upgrade to the Frostbite engine. I think NFL, like, I don't know if the latest one did, but if it hasn't, then it could definitely do with it because it looked a bit.
Does it not look great
compared to FIFA? It looks nothing like it, and considering they're all wearing helmets, so you don't really have to have the facial kind of stuff going on. It just looks a bit ropey. But
well, you're still one behind, aren't you? Because you got Madden 17.
Yeah, so that's. I mean, I don't know if 17 had it, but the one I played looked a bit.
Okay, that'll probably be in the vault soon.
Yeah, hopefully I'll give that a go as well.
And then something that you really enjoyed at Gamescom, For Honor, has a closed beta on at the moment, and you managed to get into that.
Yeah, played it. I've only played it a bit this morning. The tutorial is exactly what I played at Gamescom. Then they kind of went on to some stuff that's to do with like the multiplayer side of it that's in the beta. That basically, they're doing something that's like seasons in the game. So when you start the game, you choose which faction you want to fight for out of the Knights, the Vikings, or the Samurais. And then once you choose that, you're sort of like earning points for that faction, but you can still choose any character you want to actually fight with, but you're sort of like set to that faction. And there was details in the beta about these like seasons, so like a 10-week season, and the better you do in the game, you'll be able to... There's like areas on the map, and you kind of fill them with different soldiers and things that you unlock, and then they battle each other, and then it's like all done in the background. The more, whichever faction's got the most people built up in that area wins, and you get rewards in games and things. So that's quite cool if you're going to play it. I don't know if I'd play it for that long, a 10-week season, but and then it, like the map will change. So if you say that your faction wins like that season, the next time you go to that map, the map will slightly be different, like the aesthetics, like it'll have samurai flags hanging instead
of quite cool.
Whatever's there, so different things. But that, yeah, it looked quite cool. But I just finished at that point when he was kind of describing all that. But looking forward to it. The big thing for me is just the replayability. Like, what's this? I don't know much about the single player. That's going to be a big thing, how long the single player campaign is.
Right. Do we know when it's out?
Valentine's Day.
Oh, okay. Not long at all then.
No.
Wow. Okay. Cool. You played anything else?
The Fall is a pretty... It's weird because I've seen some people on TA, like, you know, when you can score your games after you've finished playing. Some people seem to really rate it highly. I thought it was boring, but I was obviously playing it for the quick score that it's got and using a guide, so I wasn't... Maybe there's something in the story and the puzzles, you know, if you go through and actually play it properly and discover... like the solutions to the puzzles, you might get more out of it. I just blasted through it, so I obviously didn't play it properly.
Okay.
For like 2 hour completion, yeah. And I need to start getting rid of, so I keep back doing these easy games up here, and I see them all, my friend feed people popping them. I'm like, right, I'll buy that. And then I just leave it on the console thinking, I'm not playing that. But needs must when you, I think I'm at like minus 400 or something on Monday or Tuesday this week for GTASC.
Yeah, no, you were, yeah.
And people like, you better get your finger out. So I was like, okay.
So we look like we're going to be safe, our team, this week. Jack, you played some old... Speaking of getting safe, you played some old stuff.
Yeah, I played Defense Grid 2. So this was on the evening where Dave and I were trying to dig us out of the hole.
Okay.
So there's a couple of really easy achievements on that. If you haven't played Defense Grid before, if you play the first level on it, you'll pop about 12 achievements in one go.
Wow.
Which is insane. But there are levels called Super Grinders. It's a tower defense game, and you've just got to get through 100 waves. And that is all fine. I did the Super Grinder, then moved on to the Normal Grinder. But I accepted a... I tried to play a multiplayer game, and it does the whole Xbox thing where it queues up the game and allows you to go off into the single player and then pops up and says, oh, we found a game, do you want to join it? Right. And it popped up partway through the grinder and then didn't end it for me, so I couldn't get the achievement in that mode after 25 minutes of effort, which was a bit annoying. But that means I've got that achievement for this week, so it's not the end of the world. Nice. Then I jumped back onto Rare Replay as well.
Which has a lot of achievements.
Yeah, it has a lot of achievements and a lot of high scoring achievements as well.
Yeah.
Like a lot of people have played it once and never again.
Well, it was very cheap, wasn't it? And it has a... It also has a huge nostalgia factor, but people are unlikely to have played a lot of the games. Like, I remember I've probably played a quarter of the games in the collection before when they originally came out, and I didn't really have much desire to go and play a lot of the other ones.
I think a lot of it is you remember things kind of better than they were.
Tinted glasses.
Yeah. So I've gone back to some stuff and thought, oh, this was amazing. I used to love this as a kid. And then I've gone, nah, it's not for me.
Yeah.
I'll go back to Call of Duty or Battlefield.
Yes, I agree. So, there's a load of cheap and easy gamer score and TA, well, TA for sure, on Rare Replay. So if you need score, check it out. I have played the Turing test. So I started this before Christmas. I played another maybe 4 or 5 chapters. Mm-hmm. So I'm up to like chapter 6 now, I think. The puzzles have got, some of them have got much harder, but some of them are relatively straightforward, which is good. I am using a guide as soon as I get stuck because I don't really... I mean, but I'm listening to the story stuff all the way through because that's really interesting. The computer that's talking to you all the way through is already starting to get a bit moody. So you can see something's in the works. Plus, there's loads of people that you're trying to find that are just not there. It's quite, like, spooky. But all the way through, you're just doing constant puzzles all the time. who built this stupid ship in the first place, which is just full of puzzles. So that's quite cool. And then I've started Numa, which again is actually by the same guys, because there's a cool little Easter egg in the Turing test where one of the secret achievements unlocks the first stage of Numa within the game. Okay. So I went back and thought, actually, I remember I've got that. Did it go Games with Gold?
I think it did.
So,
yeah. I think it did. That's why I've got it, because I don't think I'd have bought it otherwise. But that's quite cool. I remember playing that back at Gamescom a couple of years ago, chatting to one of the developers as I was playing it, and he was explaining quite a lot of the functionality and how it works. But that's a great game. There's loads of really cool puzzles in there that are quite easy to work out, but quite clever at the same time. So that was a lot of fun too. I've rattled off maybe 600 in that, and I've got the rest to play next week because I didn't want to waste all my easy games in one hit. Is that it from what we've been playing?
Yeah, I think so.
I know it's okay. You played Minecraft.
Oh, yes. So after I bought it last week, do you remember I said it was on sale for $6 or something, or £6 or something? Mm-hmm. I bought it, and then I had a look at one of the title update achievements, and it had a little guide to get which had a world in it for like jumping on a pig or falling on a pig or something. So I downloaded that world, and then I had literally no idea what to do. So I haven't got a controller plugged in, and I didn't know how to move my character, didn't know how to access the inventory, and every time I pressed the wrong button, I'd muck up the world, so it couldn't be used for the achievement anymore. So I've got 8 versions of that world that I've had to re-download and then start from again while I've worked out what the controls are, and I still don't really know. I'm going to plug my Xbox controller.
WASD to move. And
yeah, no, I've got the basics now, but just like inventory management and all that stuff was just like...
You'll have to jump in with me at weekend. So there's a friend I know who was trying to get to, I think it was 200,000 gamer score, and she was like getting there, but not quick enough. So she jumped in Minecraft with me, and we got 3,000 TA in about 25 minutes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I will definitely do that. Maybe we can do that.
Really easy.
On Sunday after this week's GTASC. Because, yeah, I was wandering around the like default world, and I was looking at the normal achievement list, and there were things for like mining iron and making certain things, but I couldn't. And there was one for like punching a tree, which I was just doing forever, and nothing happened. Punching this tree.
Were you clicking instead of holding the mouse button?
Yeah, because it says to punch, not to.
Yeah, you need to just hold the mouse button.
Well, I did that as well, and that just chopped it down, and then it gave me wood. Not like that. You know what I mean? It gave me a piece of wood.
Popped the achievement for punching a tree.
I didn't enjoy it that much. Yeah, but it didn't. So it was rubbish. So,
Windows 10.
They don't bloody pop. It's really annoying.
You probably have got that achievement.
Well, yeah, maybe. I don't know. So anyway, you told me that there's a world that I can download which will make all this stuff easier. But I was trying to, this is like the first time I played Minecraft, and obviously loads of people rave about Minecraft. So I was quite excited about it. But actually, all it was just wandering around, just digging a hole, and then I got stuck underwater a few times. I figured out you could put stuff down so I could build like a little bridge to get out of the water, but I don't know, I don't see the appeal. I just don't get it.
I think it's what you make of it, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think a lot of the hype comes from a PC version, but
it didn't give me wood even though it gave me wood. So I've got a load more achievements than that to get, so maybe Dave can show me how to get wood probably another time. Okay, let's move on to regular... Oh, hang on, let's... A couple of other housekeeping bits. So we've moved to Beam. We had one of the questions on the mailbag, do you like Beam? And I think we've answered that. We really like it. We're very impressed with it. I think there's a couple of teething problems, but I think the streaming app, Beam Stream, which is either going to be an app or even caked into the OS, is coming to the Xbox One in the next couple of weeks, from what I've heard, at least in the preview program. So that's pretty exciting. So other people can experience Beam too. But as ever, our one-hour videos will be up on YouTube, on our YouTube channel, and you can join us next week for 5 more ID titles that we'll be streaming, including Wells, Kill the Bad Guy, Candleman, Aqua Kitty, UDX, Pixel Heroes, Bite and Magic, which I think there's quite a lot of people excited for, and Knee Deep again, which people are excited for. Plus, there's a couple left over from this week that we'll try and cram in as well. I think Spheroids has been delayed.
Yes,
which we were going to do, but that's been pushed back. So, oh, there's Doodle God as well, and Subterrane. So there's a lot of stuff. We might do a couple of two-hour sessions next week too, because there's just so many games to get through. So, yeah, check those out. 3 p.m. UK time every day. Possibly 4 p.m. as well, depending on how many we have to do. We have set up, so you will maybe know if you look on an achievement on TA, that there is a panel at the bottom of it that shows linked trophies from True Trophies. So you could see if there wasn't a guide for an achievement on TA, and there is one on TT, you can easily see that and go over to TT and use that guide for the same achievement slash trophy in the same game. We have pushed that functionality into True Steam this week, which means that there are now Steam achievements that are linked to TA games. And while that community is relatively new, there's still something like 6,000 solutions that have been written over there. So you may well see guides on games on TA that do not have guides that you can now easily link to the guide on TSA. To see those. So that's a neat little feature. Content update. We are still working on the content update. We've got most of the data coming in nicely now, and we're just making it look pretty on the way out and adding our complicated filtering systems and all that jazz. That I know I keep saying that it's going to be live, but it will definitely go live next week. Hopefully for all three sites, but definitely for TA and True Steam. So there's going to be a load of funky functionality around that. Very easy to find sale data, new content as it goes up on the marketplace, all that sort of jazz. Regular news, Dave.
Probably the biggest one this week, February's Games with Gold was announced. Lovers in a Dangerous Space Time, which is available throughout the whole of February on the Xbox One. Then we've got Project Cars from the 16th until the 15th of March, which is a game that I remember when it came out, it had some handling issues that a lot of people...
Tell me about it. We played it at, what was it, the Gadget Show Live? I think I played it at a couple of years ago, and it was a mess. Like, the handling was all over the place. But, I think it was only on PC at the time, but it was a real mess.
Well, I think it's improved now. I'm not 100% sure, but I'll give it a try for free, see where it's at. Probably on my son's account, so I don't pop anything in it. If it and then on the Xbox 360, but obviously backwards compatible, we've got Monkey Island 2, LeChuck's Revenge. That's from 1st of February to the 15th. And then Star Wars The Force Unleashed from the 16th to the 28th. And I know that was a massive game, because that's already been back compat, I think, that one, hasn't it?
Yes, all three of them went back compat. Yeah. It's not brilliant. I've played it.
I remember it being really well, because I remember our story got pretty well. Like, it ended up on Reddit and stuff when it happened. But
yeah,
when it went back compat,
Maybe it's
I think the second one's considerably better than the first one. I thought the first one was a bit flaky.
Right, okay. But yeah, that's
games so cool. Free games, get them. I don't know anything about Lovers, do you?
No, it's been out a while, that one. I've got a feeling we might even have a review for it.
Okay.
Not 100%.
Check out the Lovers in the Dangerous.
Yes, we have. We've got an official site review. We've got a 3.5 out of 5, so.
Not bad.
Yeah,
not bad for free, anyway.
We've got the new Xbox One update has gone out to preview members. Or insiders, as they're called now. So this kind of brings us on to a lot of questions. Because one of the big changes is that they've improved the sort of like the dashboard, make things easier to access with one button click. And one of the things that has vanished is the snap functionality.
Yeah.
So there was a question from Tarragon on Twitter, and he wants to know, with Snap being removed from the Xbox One dashboard, are there any plans to update the TA app? Because obviously that was a big selling point of it, to get the guides in Snap.
Yeah. So I hate the expression reached out, but we have reached out to Microsoft about this. As far as we're aware, Snap is not coming back. The official statement from Mikey Barrow on Twitter was, and I'll quote, "We replace Snap to improve multitasking, reduce memory use, improve overall speed, and free up resources going forward for bigger things." That sounds to me like they have no intention of bringing it back at some point. I mean, I was thinking that if you had Scorpio, then you, in theory, had the grunt to probably run two apps side by side, or a game and an app side by side, without any difficulty. But I imagine that would then require different OS for Scorpio and regular Xbox One. So it's fair to say that the dashboard has seems to have got slower. It's never been like really slick. Like, you use the PS4 dashboard and it is really slick. Obviously, the Xbox One was trying to do a lot more by allowing two apps to run at the same time, and they had to reserve memory for that. Having said that, our TA app is incredibly light, and it seems a real shame that they've pulled effectively one of the most useful features of that, which was to be able to have the solutions up to the side of the screen while you're playing the game. I'm pretty upset that's happened. There's also it's not clear whether there'll be any way to replace that functionality. So there are some of the apps that are going to have links at the bottom of the guide to control them. For example, Beam. Obviously, they're going to be able to run Beam while they're playing games. And I think there's other stuff as well, like the music app and stuff. I don't actually have the preview build, the insider build at the moment, so I can't tell you exactly what's in it, but there are videos kicking about. Plus, as it's in insider mode, should we say, they will be tweaking it still before it hits the public properly.
I think one possibility I've seen is picture in picture.
Yeah, I mean, that's been talked about a while ago. The achievement
progress, haven't they? There's a little achievement progress. There's a little bar that you can have put at the bottom, because there was the whole thing around the TV that was like a big thing, wasn't it? And they even adjusted like the sound settings so you could tailor it to have your TV loud at one side, your Snap Tap louder or quieter than
and you could Skype while you were playing as well. A lot of these. It was a big thing when it was announced, the snapping. Everyone was like, wow, that's amazing, they've done that. So it's obviously a big decision that they've come to pull it. They obviously couldn't get the guide as slick as they wanted it without removing that functionality, which is a real shame. So I don't know, it's early days yet. If we are to update the TA app, there's no point doing that unless we're going to be able to do the picture-in-picture, I don't think. So we're waiting on a response about that at the moment. If we do switch it, we'd need to build it. They've discontinued the platform that we built the original app on. So we would need to build it in UWP, which means we'd lose our achievements, which so be it. I mean, while they were wonderful, they don't add anything to the actual functionality of the app. But I don't think there's much point in us completely rewriting it if we're not going to be able to have that picture-in-picture functionality, personally, because it's going to be a big undertaking. It will take up quite a lot of development time. So I don't know at the moment. We're in discussions. I'm waiting for some more details to come back. As regards our achievements, we're going to put a story up today about Snap's achievements. We will try and find a way to not make those discontinued. So if we can adjust the requirements of them, we will do so. I don't think we can change the names, so they might sound odd. But I think we can adjust the descriptions and the requirements, but I'm waiting to hear back on that as well. So watch this space. If you've got the TA app, you've not completed it and you want to, don't accept the creator's update to your Xbox One until you've got those, because they will stop it working unless you've already got the Snap ones. Next story.
Yeah, so I think it was a couple of weeks ago, we had Battlefield 3 and Bad Company 2. Back compat. This week they have been added to the EA Access Vault, which is pretty awesome. And then they've also promised coming at some point this year, Skate 3, Madden NFL 17. Woop woop. Dead Space, Ignition, and Zuma's Revenge. And on a side note, they've also confirmed that Mass Effect Andromeda you'll get the play first trial on March the 16th.
I'm so excited about that.
So you get 10 hours. 10 hours of the game. Such a great deal on EA Access. Go get it.
Yeah, it's well worth having. I can't wait for that. Cool. Okay, Skate 3. Jack, you loved that game, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah, I played its completion. All three of them I've completed.
You won't be making much use of that.
So, no, I won't be using that. But, it's good, though. Good step away from the kind of arcadey Tony Hawk's.
Yeah. It's also Zimmer's Revenge, I really enjoyed, but there's some really tricky achievements in that game.
Yeah, you've got to finish a level in under 5 seconds, I think.
Right. Yeah.
But. One that I skipped over by accident. The Xbox Rewards program, they've brought something called Freedom Rewards. Basically, you're going to be rewarding you for playing the free-to-play games and then spending money within them. So there's a few, obviously, Roblox, Warframe, DC Universe Online, that like World of Tanks. There's got a few different things you can do, like if you spend $30 on content in free-to-play games, you'll be rewarded with 2,000 credits. If you play, I think it's half an hour, in blocks of half an hour, you'll be entered into, like, competitions that I get drawn. So there's a few things I linked to it. There's quite a few different ways you can earn points, but most of them tend to involve you spending money.
To get a little bit, a tiny bit back.
Yeah, so unless you play them games, that wouldn't be something I'll be doing. But the draw's not bad. If you can just leave, like, Roblox playing in the background to get your 20-day achievement and get entered into a draw. There's, like, a 4K TV and all kinds of stuff in there. I shall link to that one. Square Enix and Marvel have announced a multi-game partnership. So there hasn't been any sort of Marvel games for a little while. There's obviously Guardians of the Galaxy on the way from Telltale. And they've announced that there's going to be the Avengers Project. Not really a great deal of information. There's a trailer on there that you can have a look at. I'll link to that. Obviously, Rich spoke about DiRT 4, just to confirm it is coming to Xbox One on June the 9th. So
yep.
They're on fire. That's the announced, what was it, Micro Machines last week, and that's coming out pretty soon. And then it's in June. Because we all assumed that you were going to play Micro Machines, didn't we?
Yes. Totally wrong. Never mind.
Nope. A game that I know Jack's sort of like interested in from what he's seen at E3, Prey, the rebooted version, is going to be released on May the 5th. Is that one you think you'll pick up, Jack?
Yeah, I think so. From the footage I've seen, it looks really interesting. It's kind of like Dead Space, but all the enemies can transform into other objects, and it looks a bit scarier. It's going to be interesting to see what they've done with it, because it is literally a reboot in a totally different direction.
Yeah,
I don't think any of the story relates to the first at all.
No. But it looks quite interesting. There's a new gameplay trailer as well that came with the announcement, so I'll link that and you can check that out. And that's sort of like the biggest news pieces of the week.
Cool. Let's have some questions. We opened up the mail. Oh, no, sorry. Back compact news. Okay. It's been a relatively quiet week.
Yeah, I've only had three games come to back compat this week. We had Alice Madness Returns, and Shadows of a Damned, and Rocket Knight.
Okay.
Three games I know nothing about. I think Alice is quite well regarded. I remember quite a few people
about that one. I've got Shadow of a Damned on my console. I've played that, but I can't remember it at all. Okay. I only got about two achievements in it, but it means I can go back to it on my Xbox One, play it again.
Sure does. Questions?
Yep. Matt Cena on Twitter asks, I have completed Witcher 3. Is it worth replaying on the hardest difficulty?
No. Is there an achievement for it? If there is, then yes. If not, then
no. Still no.
Not a game I've played, but people obviously love it. People saying it's the best RPG ever. I'd say, if you enjoyed it, then why not replay it again and give yourself a bit more of a challenge?
If you enjoyed it, I think that's a big if.
Yeah.
There's a game of the... Why don't you play the Game of the Year edition and stack it?
Yeah. Good point.
That's the answer.
Or if you've only played the Game of the Year, get the original and stack it again. I'll play it on PlayStation, buy a PlayStation and play it on
there. Yeah, very cheap.
And join True Trophies.
Exactly. Get it on Steam.
Get it on everything.
Even buy a PlayStation then.
Another question from Tarragon via Twitter. Have you guys reached any decisions about UHH3, Ultimate Head-to-Head 3?
No, not yet.
There you go.
It will be in my mind in about a month, I would have thought. There's a lot of stuff to get done. But I'm thinking of some sort of league would be better, a long-running league. System. So that's my general idea in my head at the moment, but it needs formulating more.
Isaac the Shook very cheekily said, I know you guys aren't really completionists.
I don't know what you're saying there.
His completion percentage is lower than mine, so that's
just, is it?
Yeah.
Wow, you're lower than mine. Is anyone's lower than mine? What am I on? I'm 41%. I think I've been on 41% forever.
You must need like about 10,000 achievements to go up 1% at this stage, I think.
Yeah.
but his question is, I know you guys aren't really completionists, but sometimes you might get a game where you just feel like completing it, even though it sucks to finish. So are there any games where you spent a lot of time and effort boosting out the last few achievements just so you could get the completion? Rich?
I can't remember any. There probably is. How about Roblox?
Yeah,
I spent 20 days getting that one, the last 20 one.
20 horrible days.
In fact, I haven't completed that game, so that's wrong. Because I've still got to do those co-op ones, almost.
You did all the stuff in GTA 4, was it, didn't you?
Don't even go there. I'm on 99.8% completion on GTA A4. I got all the pigeons, I went and did all the stunt jumps, I did absolutely everything that you have to do. But there's one random encounter with Eddie, I assume it's Eddie, having looked back at the list, that didn't happen, and it won't happen, no matter how long I've driven around the place where he spawns. So I haven't completed GTA 4 because of that, which is really depressing, because, yeah, I spent a good sort of 10 hours going and doing all the pigeons. I really enjoyed the pigeon stuff. It's really weird. Like, I quite enjoyed doing the feathers on Assassin's Creed 2. Some people hate all that stuff, but I don't know, with a decent guide, I actually found it quite fun just moving around the world, going to do all that. But yeah, mainly because I knew that there was a huge TA achievement at the end of it, which I didn't get. It was just like really frustrating. Peggle 2, I got all the ones for the challenges in that. That was quite a long process, all the optional challenges, but it was well enjoyable game. I love that. There's probably loads of them, but I can't remember anymore off the top of my head.
Any for you, Jack?
I remember Project Gotham Racing 3 being a little bit of a grind. I think that was one of the first 360 games I played, and then I went back to it a couple of years later to tidy it up when they announced the server closures for it. But you've got to complete all of the events with gold medal or platinum medals, I think, which was quite terrible to do. you needed a DLC car, which was free, to be able to do some of them easily. But I've got tons of stuff sitting around there that I have intentions of finishing, but I just need to sink for time in, like Infinite Undiscovery. There's a one GamerScore achievement I need in that, but it involves playing through the game another two times on harder difficulties.
Oh, suck that.
Yeah. Yeah, Rare Replay is obviously a massive grind anyway. Kane and Lynch, I've done all the online on all of the versions, but I've got to play through the game of a single player, which is really boring because I've got to do it co-op, and it's local only, so that's a two controller setup. There's Project Spark as well. That was a bit of a grind.
Oh yeah, getting people to
They announced the server stuff for that, and getting 100 downloads of your world within 24 hours, that was a pain.
Cool. I guess for me, the obvious ones would be any of the Forza games I've completed, 3, 4, 5, that always end up like grinding like 100 hours of finishing races after you've done everything else. UFC Undisputed 3, 500 online fights. Gears 2, getting to re-upping and getting my wings, and grinding out however many kills. Is it 100,000 for Seriously 2.0?
The horde mode on that as well.
Doing horde, yeah. So there's quite a few. Like, when I get into a game and I want to complete it, I will do it. It's just recently with, like, switching around for reviews and stuff that I kind of sit games down. Like, normally I would try and complete as much as possible in a game. And if it's hard, I'll keep going until I just think I can't do it anymore. Like, I admit defeat, or I'll just keep grinding away. But there's loads of, like, Fight Night and stuff. I've got loads on my Sniper Ghost Warrior, the original one. I think it was 2,000 kills online in a game that involves people sitting in bushes.
Wow, let's not go there. Final question.
Yeah, last one from Rusty Randolph, again over Twitter. Have you thought of adding someone to the podcast who plays RPGs?
Yes, actually. I realise that we are very similar in the three of our play styles and the stuff we play. So I have spoken to Mark, who was on our end of year roundup, who does have experience in RPGs, loves all things really. So yeah, hopefully Mark will become a semi-regular guest on the show to mix it up a bit and talk about some of the games that the three of us don't talk about very often. So hopefully that will start from next week. But watch this space.
Okay, and that's it for my bulging sack this week.
Good stuff. New achievement list. We've had quite a few.
Yeah, we have. So we've had a couple of AAAs. We've had Resident Evil 7, 37 achievements. That's the biggest title of this week. And then there was Resident Evil 7 Grotesque Version, which is a Japanese-only release. It's just an uncensored version, but it's stackable.
So is the UK one censored then?
The UK one, I don't think it's censored, but if you use the link in Japan to buy the one that's on the UK marketplace, it'll be the censored version, if that makes sense. So if I buy it from here, it'd be uncensored, but if the Japanese person buys it, it'd be censored, unless they buy the Grotesque version.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a little bit weird.
Right, okay. So basically what you're saying is there's two versions available in Japan.
Yeah, there's two versions available in Japan, yeah, but you can also buy, if you've got a Japanese credit card.
I'll get mine out. One as well. Yeah.
I've got five of them.
Have we got a Japanese company card we can all buy that on?
It's the exact same achievement list, though, so if you played the first one and loved it and do want to play it again, you can pick that up.
It's fair to say the reviews have been spectacular for this game.
Yeah.
If you like, but also back to the terrifying nature of the early games. So if you are into your horror games, check out Resi 7.
Have you not thought about picking it up on a PlayStation VR?
No, I've saw a video of some bloke lying on the floor in a fetal position with a VR headset on, playing it. I was like, there's no way I'm doing that. No way. I don't like scary things at the best of times. Imagine a VR world with Resi 7 in it. I don't think my heart would take it.
Okay, so after that, we had Towerfall Ascension, which we played earlier this week, and you can catch the video for on YouTube. It's worth noting that game initially scanned with a load of 0-point achievements.
Yeah.
At the end of it, and the scores have now been attributed to those.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that is a DLC pack with 6 achievements for 500 gamer score.
Wow.
Yeah, which isn't bad.
How much is the DLC, though? We don't know.
The DLC is $10.
What?
So the game, I think, is $15. The DLC is $10. So it's 20.
I think I read in English it was like 12 and 8, which is 20 quid is a lot of money.
Yeah. But then up after that, we have Pixel Heroes, Bison Magic with 55 achievements.
Streaming next week.
Mm-hmm. Then 88 Heroes with 36 achievements, and all of the achievements are related in some way to 88. So you've got like get 8,888 points, die 88 times.
Yeah, I remember seeing this.
Which is quite interesting. And then earlier today, we just had Uncanny Valley scan with 12 achievements.
Okay. Don't know too much about that one.
Yeah, we've had apart from the Towerfall DLC, we've had a title update hit for Overwatch, which is the Year of the Rooster event for Chinese New Year. That's got two achievements for 30 gamer score, and it adds a capture a flag mode to the game.
Cool. Okay, new releases. We have, so there's a load of stuff today. Doodle God, Ultimate Edition, Subterrane, and the Sun and Moon. Which one are we streaming today?
Sun and Moon.
Sun and Moon, okay. Cool. And then we have next week. In fact, we just heard from ID about the stuff that's coming next week. So on Monday, we have Wells.
Mm-hmm.
On Tuesday, we have Kill the Bad Guy. On Wednesday, we have Candleman. And then next Friday, we have Aqua Kitty UDX, Pixel Heroes, Bite and Magic, and Knee Deep all coming at once. We will add those to our release calendar because they're not on there at the moment. Is that it for new releases? Let me just check. Kill the Bad Guy, we already had. Candleman is there. And then next Friday, yeah, as well as that, we have Gimme 5, which was supposed to be coming out in December. We did the achievement reveal for it, and it's now coming out on the 3rd of Feb.
Mm-hmm.
We've had it confirmed from the developer. So lots of ID stuff coming out in next week. And then finally, in February, we've got some... Do we have some big titles coming? Yeah, we've got Forerunner in, as Dave mentioned, on the 14th of Feb. Ride 2 finally hits the US on the same day. Sniper Elite 4, which I believe might be an ID title this
year. Yeah, it is. It's...
Okay, which is interesting. And then the following week, we've got Halo Wars 2 and the definitive edition of Halo Wars. So we're getting some AAA stuff as well as... and Lego Worlds, as well as the ID stuff in Feb. So it should be a good month.
But did you say Lego Worlds is a bit different than like the normal...
Yeah, it's more of a GTA style.
Lego GTA.
That appears
already. How good that I got.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks good. It looks really good. I'll see if we can go and see that in advance. Fantastic. Okay, thank you, guys. Any other business?
No, I think that's it.
Cool. Okay, we will see you next week when hopefully we will also have Mark on the show. Have a good week. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.